Good evening, everybody. Thank you very much for that warm, singular response. My name is Conor Gearty, and I am chairing this evening's discussion, Enriching Our Lives, Why the Humanities and Social Sciences Matter Now. And what we've got is a partnership. The British Academy and the small print you might not be able to read for the Humanities and Social Sciences on the left, and LSE's Institute of Public Affairs, of which I'm director, on the right. And the Academy has been greatly interested in establishing a good case for research in the Humanities and Social Sciences. That it can be made is clear, that it is different from the case made by science is also clear. We're not able to prove that we can cure things, and we're not able to establish how you can build bridges and so on, so we have a different perspective on things. And the Academy has published, which Nick has in front of him and possibly will now wave, a little magazine which is also accessible with all sorts of gizmos. You'd never have thought the British Academy was capable of it. Double clicks that open all sorts of things on the web. And it's called Prospering Wisely. And it's the Academy's effort to engage in this discussion about the importance of humanities and social sciences. So I think what we're going to do is, this is what we're going to do. Let's have no spurious democracy here. We're going to have a little introductory video, and then I'm going to ask Nick to speak, introducing him ever so briefly, then Julia, then, and we're delighted to have an alum, Greg Clark, minister, and then we're going to have a little interchange between us, and then over to you, and we're supposed to end at something like 25 past 7. So that's the menu. And I'm reliably assured that there is a human being in the room who will now be able to actualize, to misuse a word, a video which will tell you a little bit about what the Academy has been doing in this arena by way of introduction. What is it, about 3 minutes long?
Something like that.
The guests may want to look at it.
Probably a good idea.
They may not.
Prosperity. What does it mean and how can it be fostered? How can people and communities have the opportunity to prosper and realise their full potential? How can they expand their capabilities, as Amartya Sen puts it, so as to lead the kind of lives they value and have reason to value? That's the kind of question the British Academy's Prospering Wisely project has been exploring.
Prosperity is a very broad concept. It's way beyond income or consumption, or wealth measured in a material sense. It's how we live our lives, how we deal with uncertainty and anxiety, what our sense of community, relationships and society really is. The idea of Prospering Wisely is to try to understand what some, not all, but some of the objects of public policy should be, and also to understand how those objects might be pursued. As you start phrasing the question that way, immediately, the whole of humanities and social sciences come in.
The sciences can tell us wonderful things about how to heal illness, how to cure particular sorts of malaise, but it's historians, it's the humanities, it's social sciences who talk about the malaise in society, explain the mysterious ways in which human beings behave to each other, which are not susceptible of putting into formulae. They are that mysterious thing, human nature. That's what we deal with. And if you don't have a healthy humanities, social sciences sector, your country will go mad.
I think that the quality of the interface between public life and public curiosity and the humanities and the social sciences has never been better than it is now. I personally feel that there is more interest in matters of the mind and society and culture, interest in understanding ourselves and understanding our origins and where we're going to in the future, than at any point during my own career.
I think we've got a fantastic opportunity to
expand intelligent public debate, which is informed by all the kinds of different aspects of the areas of study that the Academy represents.
It's clearly becoming more and more urgent that we learn how to live more harmoniously with people who have very different notions of what a society is. That's more evident every day. And that makes it even more important that we find ways to use collections like the British Museum and the other collections across the country to explain how the world can be thought in different ways. And that requires the contribution of those working in the humanities and the social sciences in universities.
What it's about is defining the ideas that make our society function and operate. And that's what people studying the humanities for the last 2,000 years has enabled us to do.
The humanities and social sciences are about understanding and taking decisions when you haven't got a magic wand. They're about understanding the difficult issues of our time, identity, community, relationships, societies, all which require something about public policy and decision making. The key is to bring principles and ideas to very difficult and complex decision making and understanding so that we can find a way forward. It's important to remind government, indeed those who make decisions and allocate resources wherever they are in society, just how powerful a resource we are, just how much our activities matter.
As was indicated, there's a website where you can get much more of that. And it has these interviews and so on at some length. So now we have three interventions, shortish, preparatory to the discussion. I'm delighted to ask my colleague, the president of the Academy, and of course a prof here, Nick Stern, to kick us off. Nick.
Would you like us to stay here or to stand up?
I think it's how you feel.
I feel
relaxed.
I'll stand up. If
stand.
That's all right. Yeah.
And as a lawyer, I must point out this is no precedent for Professor Black or Dr. Clark. Did you get your PhD?
I did.
Dr. Clark.
is this one working?
Yeah.
Yeah. And thank you all for coming. Thank you, Greg, particularly for coming because we're supposed to be here. But you have, actually you're supposed to be here as well, but you have jobs which
you're
are very demanding elsewhere. Now, the British Academy does the humanities and the social sciences, and it tries to be excellent. You sound terribly pompous if you say we're after excellence, but I guess we are. But it's not just the importance of the subject and the idea that you've got some people who are quite good at it. That doesn't by itself constitute a persuasive argument for anybody to support you. You've got to show what you do. And actually you don't want to spend much time arguing for support. You just want to spend your time discussing the big issues, discussing what matters, discussing evidence, discussing meaning. And as you do that, you hope that you are being useful and other people will see it. So that's what I think we should focus on tonight. Not special pleading, but having a look at our subjects at work. And that's what we want to try to share. That's what Prospering Wisely was trying to do. Let me begin by saying that I think at the moment we see in many Western societies, and I would suspect well beyond Western societies, a hunger for this kind of discussion. If you look at disaffection with politics. I think Gus O'Donnell quotes that the membership of all the political parties put together is less than that of the Royal Society for the Protection of Birds. Now, I actually am a member of the Royal Society for Protection of Birds, I think it's rather good, but that is a reflection, as it were, of worry and dislike, anxiety about politics and political institutions. It's other institutions too, often religious institutions, sometimes the police and the law. I think you see a worry about how our societies are functioning and a worry about the ideas that lie behind them and the institutions and how they work and the politics. Of course, a worry about my own subject in particular, economics, which has quite rightly come under the under hot examination in recent times. So I think there's never been, that's too strong, there is now a very powerful desire to discuss the difficult issues about how societies function, what it is that we're about. So that's what I want to focus the remarks on. Let me begin with, and I'll appeal to a number of fellows of the British Academy and their contributions, and indeed actually appeal to a number of the past presidents of the British Academy in so doing. But the first thing we do is ask who we are and what we seek as human beings, what it means to be human. Now, the humanities are up that end, but everything I talk about will see humanities flowing into what the social scientists think they do, and the social scientists flowing into what the people in the humanities think they do, so trying too hard to pull them apart is just not worth it. But who we are and what we seek. If you think of Amartya Sen, who in wearing his philosopher's hat as well as his economist's hat, he's asked about identity and justice and capability and empowerment. Honora O'Neill, one of my predecessors as president of the Academy, I think has given the most illuminating insight into trust, or as she says, actually it's not so much about trust, it's about understanding trustworthiness. Now, she argues you want less trust in the untrustworthy and more trust in the trustworthy, so that moves trustworthiness to centre stage. Those of you who she's got a wonderful TED talk with over 1 million hits. Actually, if you want 10 minutes exploring this, go to Honora O'Neill's TED talk. If you think of Keith Thomas, a very distinguished historian, former president of the Academy, has written about the ends of life, a very insightful historical view of what now is put under the heading of well-being, what it is that people seek. I always stay away from happy. I always think that, I mean, it's nice to be happy, but if happiness is the only objective, then you got chemicals. But but if you ask what we seek and what is fulfilling, what makes us anxious, all those are very important questions. What it is that people seek in this case was Keith Thomas's contribution on the ends of life. It's more than that, of course. It's not just what people are looking after. It's the societies they live in and key things about those societies. And Isaiah Berlin, as a former president of the Academy, asking about the meaning of liberty and putting that under the spotlight. I think once you go into those issues and think about the contributions, you realise how much these things matter. Not as just as academic seminars, but people really do put liberty and justice and well-being and trust and trustworthiness at the centre of their lives. You don't have to argue that it matters. People, I think, respond directly that it does matter to them. And thus being clear-headed and thoughtful about what these things really mean does matter. Let me turn now to more explicit social science approaches and the emphasis on evidence. Again, I think that our subjects, when they're practiced well, really show how powerful evidence can be. If you look at the Behavioural Insights team, which went to the centre of government and asked not just how do people behave, but how can our understanding of how people behave help with policy? So when will people insulate their lofts? What kind of service can you provide which makes it more likely that they'll insulate their lofts. It turns out that what worries people most about their lofts is all the junk they've got in them, and their hearts sink at the necessity to sort it out, so they never get insulated. But if you offer a service which organises their junk, and you can promise to put it back exactly where it was before, or you can promise to sort it for them and dump half of it, whichever it is that makes it easier for them. You know, there are the stories of, you know, opt-in and opt-out of pension schemes. You give people exactly the same choice, but if they have to tick to opt-out or tick to opt-in, you get very different results. That's very important information. It's information, actually, that has to be used with great care. Now, who are you to steer them towards their better self and get them to opt out of the pension contributions rather than opt in? I think you probably should, but you'd have to think hard about what gives you that right. But those are examples of the importance of evidence. If you think of John Hills's work, LSE and British Academy, on fuel poverty, and the biggest way of fighting fuel poverty is to insulate the houses of old poor people. It's, in my view, and this is Nick Stern's observation coming in here, it's absolutely bonkers to have lower VAT on energy. It's much better to spend the money on helping people who really are poor, and John Hill showed how that was the most effective of the insulating old people's, poor old people's houses, the most effective way of combating fuel poverty. If you think of Tony Atkinson's work on the inequality. Tony Atkinson, the teacher of Thomas Piketty. Nice boy, Thomas, but he's a student of Tony Atkinson. And you go back to the master. And Tony's work, for example, which is being published in April, well, Tony's been publishing on this ever since I've known him, which is the late 1960s. But Tony's been publishing, and he's been the absolute, he's been quite an extraordinary leader in sorting out the quality of data, assembling it, and showing what's going on. A remarkable thing has happened in British society, which I hope will get much more scrutiny in this election campaign than perhaps it has in the past. We were right up to the 1980s, at the end of the 1970s, we were up the a bit more equal end of OECD countries. And that jumped up quite phenomenally. I mean, Gini coefficients jumping up from 0.25 to 0.35 in household income per capita. It jumped right up in the 1980s to around 0.35. Huge increase in a decade or so. And we moved up from a bit better than the average, if you think less inequality is better, to a bit more. And in fact, a lot more unequal than the average of the OECD countries. And it stayed that way since the early 1980s, whichever government has been there. It's been a very important observation on British society, which I think actually hasn't had the scrutiny that it should. We were a fairly equal society, we changed in the 1980s, and we've stayed unequal, at least a lot more unequal, during that period, notwithstanding which governments we've seen over that period. That's evidence that really matters to how we think about ourselves. So I think these are the kinds of evidence, you know, what works, what doesn't work, which was the sort of John Hill's behavioural insights team sort of story, and then who are we and what have we become, the Tony Atkinson kind of story. I could go on, but you can see the kind of thing that I'm driving at. The evidence and putting it out in a systematic way changes and should change the nature of the discussions that we have about who we are and what we do. Of course, it's not just understanding and solving, it's also sometimes it's our duty to be difficult. And there are times when academics are a key locus of awkwardness, and that's part of democracy. And you see around the world, when you get repressions, they start with the universities. And in a sense, if you want to put down repression, if you want to be repressive, it's an intelligent place to start, the universities, because that's where the challenge and difficultness, being difficult, should be. It's not just being difficult, it's also doing things that other people can't do. And that you saw Neil McGregor here, and I'm deputy chair of the trustees of the British Museum. And we've done two things which I'll draw attention to which surely can be seen. Soft power is not a very elegant term, and I go to Helen Wallace here, our foreign secretary, to get more elegant terms for this kind of thing. But we lent, and it was a very difficult discussion in the board of the British Museum, we lent the Cyrus cylinder to Iran several years ago. Cyrus cylinder, wonderful thing, 500 or so BC, which was really one of the first declarations of human rights. It was on clay. That was the that was the Facebook, or earlier days, the Xerox and so on, of the Samizdat of the time. And it sets out, this is Cyrus conquering that area of Iraq. He sets out how to treat conquered nations. He sets out the right of return, pretty relevant to that part of the world now. He sets out freedom of religion. It was greatly admired by Thomas Jefferson. So we sent it. It was very against the advice of the Foreign Office, explicitly against the advice of the Foreign Office. We sent it to Iran at a time when relations were very difficult. That's what you can do. That's what, it seems to me, the humanities, the culture, the social sciences should do, to bring nations together, promote understanding between peoples. You can't do that kind of thing unless you really understand what you've got. You need the British Museum and all the study and the scholarship and the history to go, to make that kind of thing happen. And we've just lent a river god to the Hermitage. Again, at a time when relationship with Russia were not good. This time we didn't ask the Foreign Office what they thought. We told them the night before so they wouldn't be completely blindsided. But I think we helped them because we didn't give them the chance to object. And they probably wouldn't have wanted the chance to object because they wouldn't have known what to do with the chance to object. And that's reaching out to the other great museum which embodies the values of the Enlightenment, which is the Hermitage, founded at a very close, similar time to the British Museum. Those were very important public acts by a public institution, British Museum, which was not the government, and fiercely asserted its independence from government. These are the kinds of things that we do, it seems to me, that makes our subjects so valuable and so exciting. I'm an economist, I haven't quantified any of those things, but I think, I hope, you'd recognise that they're all important. I could go on about many things. I think I've spoken about who we are, what we seek. I've spoken about evidence. I've spoken about occasionally being awkward, about soft power. I think our subjects are good at identifying the big challenges of our time. Aging, urbanization, security of various kinds, climate change, I guess I would say that, wouldn't I? But it is one of the big challenges of our time. And most of these things, I hope it's obvious, require virtually everything we've got in terms of intellectual ammunition to take them on. You can't talk about climate without thinking about the science, about the technology, about the economics, about the ethics of what we do now relative to what comes later, without thinking about international relations, without thinking from psychology about how people really do behave and understand problems which are stochastic in the sense they're uncertain. They are on a scale way outside human experience. They've got very long lags and they involve public goods. The science has made that problem just about as difficult as it could be. And all those things, that it's stochastic, it's on a huge scale outside experience, involves very long lags, and is public in the sense that it doesn't matter whether that ton of carbon comes from Johannesburg or from London or Beijing. All those things are in the science, but that science has thrown up problems of uncertainty, scale, lags, public goods, ethics, which are deep in our subjects. And you couldn't expect to have a serious discussion of those issues without integrating all those things together. And that's really the last theme of what I wanted to say, is that most big problems, I won't say all, but most big problems and most challenges involve the interweaving of all those subjects. We should celebrate the interweaving. We should go about, walk arm in arm, study, understand with our fellow academics in science and technology, engineering, medicine. We should work with them to take on these very big issues. It's why many of us bridle against a kind of spitting contest, I could use another verb, but a kind of spitting context between STEM on the one hand and humanities and social sciences on the other. It's just daft. I mean, it shows a lack of understanding of what the issues are at the heart of these subjects. So it's clear in climate change. I could have gone, and Alan Wilson is here, is one of our great lead thinkers about the way cities work. And he started life as a mathematician, and he's a fellow of the British Academy and of the Royal Society. You can't understand cities. You know, where 50% of the population now live, 3.5 billion people, by 2050 it'll be 70% of 9-some billion, that'll be 6.5 billion people. We're going to see 3 billion more people in our cities in the next 35 years. That is fast forward, quite extraordinary pace of change. You can't understand those problems without putting all the various subjects together. An oil company is logistics, finance, anthropology, international relations, lawyers, yeah? Primarily, but and more things. Of course, it's a bit of geology and a bit of kit attached as well. You say that to people in oil companies, say, yeah, of course. But we think of, you know, it as some subject which is outside the humanities and the social sciences. Virtually all activity of seriousness, all challenges which we have to rise to, involve that interweaving. So one thing that we don't do when we talk about the humanities and social sciences is to set them against the other subject. That is confusion and basically dishonest. Of course, we should resist when other people do that, because they, if they insist that it's only the STEM subjects that are productive, they miss the point. But we don't meet that point by dissing the STEM subjects. We meet that point by showing how important the integration is, and that's what we try to do. Now, if you do the counting, nearly, you know, vast majority of cabinet ministers come from humanities and social sciences. A significant majority of the heads of big companies come from the humanities and social sciences. 75% of our economy is services. The biggest growth of productivity, well, if you take the years before we got into the stagnation of 2008, fastest rate of growth of productivity is in the a lot of the service sectors, particularly some of the business and retail service sectors. So you can see, actually, if you play the game of counting and economic growth and so on, our subjects are absolutely central and important drivers of productivity and economic growth. Manufacturing and the cultural and creative industries are now about equal, 8%, 9%, 10% of the economy, and probably the cultural creative industry is growing a bit faster than manufacturing. But you don't have to set these things against each other. That's a mistake. What we see is an economy where our subjects and the STEM subjects come together, and if managed well, really produce a dynamic economy. And if they're studied well, they produce a society which is thinks hard about standard of living, but also about values, liberty, democracy, and so on. So few sort of numbers at the end, but that's not where I wanted to begin. But the numbers do count, and the productivity does count, and that is a part of our argument, actually, on which we are on very secure ground. Thanks very much.
Thanks. Thanks, Nick, very much. Next we have the what we call Pro Director Research here at LSE, my colleague and friend Julia Black, who is also a professor of law. Julia, stand up as well.
Okay. We are a common law system.
There's precedence been created for you.
Absolutely. So good evening, everybody. And my many things that I wanted to focus on have been addressed by Nick, but I think one of my briefs here was to talk about what does it mean for the LSE to be a centre of excellence. It's quite an interesting question. And first of all, we are a centre of excellence. So I think that's both in terms of our research, in terms of our teaching. We did fantastically in the ref. I have to say that we came, you know, overall, it was imperial first, us second. So that's just brilliant. You know, we are top for social sciences on practically any measure. And there was a point at which I think there were over 14 universities claiming to be in the top 10. Actually in the ref, but no matter which way you slice and dice it, we did really, really well. But also we came, one of the new elements of our research excellence framework, research evaluation exercise, was for the first time universities had to put in documented evidence of the impacts of their research. Not just their impacts on teaching, but what effects research has had outside academia, both on policy making, on the way we understand ourselves, on culture, on curricula, the way we've taught, and so forth. And that was a new challenge for universities, but in fact for the LSE it really has just been part of our DNA. The LSE was established for the betterment of society. That is the founding principle of the Fabians, who first started the LSE with a view really to improving public administration, improving the way that we manage ourselves, we organise ourselves, and that has really been central to the mission of the LSE ever since. And so for us, engaging with those outside academia, thinking about how we can affect policy, how we can manage ourselves, understand ourselves, how we select the risks that we're going to try and manage for the future, has been an integral part of what we've always done. And just to highlight some of those areas in which we work, I mean, we are known as the clues in the title, the London School of Economics and Political Science. Obviously, sometimes the political science gets dropped off the end. And we do an awful lot of economics, both in the economics department and quite a lot of economics outside the economics department in the LSE as well. We have our Centre for Economic Performance, we have the What Works Centre, we have Spatial Economic Research Centre looking at all sorts of different aspects that Nick's been talking about in terms of economic growth and urban design. But we also work in a phenomenal wide range of areas in addition to that. So in relation to health, for example, as Nick's talked about, we have to work in partnership with scientists. We have, for example, going through, and I haven't managed to catch up with the vote today in the House of Commons, we have going through the House of vote in the House of Commons about whether you can have an embryo fetus created using the DNA from three people. Now, science has enabled that possibility, but actually it's the ethical implications of that, and then it's actually the management and the regulation and the implementation of that policy which actually has to be considered in terms of how do we then manage and want to choose to react to what it is that science can enable us as a society to do. Do we want to take that choice? And which way do we want to go on that? So those issues, as Nick said, have to be taken in context and they have to be taken in partnership with scientists. In terms of health, so yes, health pharmaceutical companies can produce drugs, but within LSE we've looked at, well, actually, how do you administer a disease eradication program on a mass scale in sub-Saharan Africa? Yes, you can produce the lovely pill, but how do you get people to take that pill in the right way, in a way which is actually going to eradicate the disease that it's been designed to address? How do you motivate health workers to actually deliver the type of healthcare that the scientists, the medics, etc., have decided and have shown that is actually going to be effective? But we also engage with the foundations of science, with the philosophy of science. How should you use evidence, evidence-based from clinical trials, which are done in a nice randomised setting? How can you take that work and actually then put it into a real-life situation where patients are taking this medication in a wider context? Or take into example in relation to climate change. Yes, science gives us some of the problems and might be able to use that to find some of the answers. But in terms of thinking about the risks going forward for climate change, how should we be thinking about that? Should we be thinking about, should we use these very heavily dense probabilistic models to deal with this uncertainty, or actually better up facing up to it and using much more scenario-based analysis, okay, rather than those other different forms? How, in fact, do models travel through the policy process? How are they selected? How are we making those choices which we're being asked to confront? And all that work we do here at the LSE, we do engaging in all of those different issues. In relation to, Nick talked about cities, and one of the key issues, obviously, in relation to growing population, etc., is the move to cities, to think about space and urban design in terms of economic growth, but also in terms of compact planning, in terms of health and well-being, and in terms of environmental qualities and thinking about green cities. We also look at ranging from that into any other item that you really want to pick out of a newspaper. We will have some research which is going on in the LSE which is going to be relevant for that. I used to teach, it was all of a year ago, it seems like about 10 years ago, regulation of financial markets, and pretty much every single class I would go into, I'd say, did you see in the FT this week? Did you see in the papers this week? It was about this, this, and this. And the work is absolutely of direct relevance. So if I take it to, for example, conflict. Unfortunately, we have a lot of that going on, and we've got LSE work which goes on looking at the protection of refugees and displaced persons, whether they be in Sudan or whether they be asylum seekers within the EU. We've got work that's going on in relation to designing protections, legal protections for violence against women. That was not part of the international legal regime until LSE research and LSE academics campaigned, because quite a lot of campaigning that goes on as well, to actually have those laws changed. Similarly, in relation to how we handle conflict situations and the need for to protect human security. We also, and I have to give a plug for various people in the audience here, we also look at how our elected representatives are actually using the powers and performing the roles that we ask them to do, in Vote Watch, for example, which actually had the interesting effect of actually making them do their job better, nothing like a bit of transparency if you actually record it. And then, as Nick was saying, we engage in socio-economic policies, and that doesn't always make us popular, and we go right across the economic and socio-economic range. We go from fuel poverty to financial markets. Okay, so we run from looking at how we should best effectively manage child protection regimes, fighting cutbacks in legal aid, things about minimum wage, student fees, all the way through to the handling of the Eurozone crisis. Okay, so we raise right across that spectrum here. Now, what does that mean, therefore, to be a centre of excellence in this? Well, it means a lot of work, actually, but it also means a lot of engagement. And it means a lot of engagement with students, because in training people to think and to go out into the world, then hopefully we're training them to address these and many other problems which we all have to face as a society going forward. But it also means that we ourselves have to engage with policymakers and with those outside academia. And often we do this on a very unsung and often unpaid basis. And for me and many of my colleagues, it's the email, could you just, would you mind coming to, we're holding an event, we're holding a forum, we'd like a panel, could you just read this consultation paper to go out, could we just have a chat with you, could we have lunch, could we have coffee? And that is from the UK government all the time, and from the European policymakers, and from all the other different international organisations and national governments in which we're all involved in our different research. It's not highly visible, it's not necessarily with a big fanfare, and it's very rarely accredited. Okay, but it goes on all the time. So we have to, as universities, I think, actually make more of a splash about what it is that we do. We have to communicate better to those outside the academy the impacts that we are having. That is part of our public duty, not only to enable the betterment of society, but to show to society how we are enabling it to better itself. Thank you.
Thank you. Very much, Julian. Now, it's a great pleasure, actually, to welcome Greg Clark. It's fair to say, Greg, when David Wills stopped doing the job, there's a slight degree of nervousness in the university sector.
Not least on my part.
The response, we always try to be perpetually negative, but we weren't able to muster that much negativity. So, obviously, you're an alum of LSE, and you've got a grand title, Minister for Universities, Science and Cities.
Indeed.
So we're delighted you've come to LSE, repeating the welcome given you by Nick, and the floor is in whichever shape
Thank
you wish
you,
to
well,
take
I'm
it, yours.
I'm going to stand over here, but it's great to be back at LSE, and I'm very grateful for the invitation to come back. And let me say a bit about the policy environment. But I do my earliest memories of LSE. In fact, Well, coming from Cambridge, you asked me whether I was an undergraduate here at the beginning. And I said no, but then I hesitated, because I sort of was. Because in my final year at Cambridge, I was doing a dissertation on pay and how it influences behaviour. And this caused a kind of few kind of quizzical looks in Cambridge, and they decided the place where they can talk about this is LSE. So they packed me off on the train down here to LSE to be supervised by Saul Esrin. And so he did that. Then needless to say, anyone that's supervised by Saul Esrin instantly gets the bug, and I wasn't allowed to leave until I'd completed my PhD in the subject. So I was sort of a covert undergraduate here as well. My training as a postgraduate and doing my PhD here, of course, was where I made most of my discoveries about how you think about the world, to the point, and I'm sure everyone here finds the same, that it's impossible to believe that anyone else can think about the world in a different way if you've trained as a social scientist. And often comes as a surprise to find that people, that what is obvious to you is not obvious to everyone else. But I... and for me, the kind of thrill of social science and the thrill of discovery was right there when you have a data set and you're plunging in it and you don't know what it's going to show, and then you start to do the regressions and the coefficients come up sort of flashing with significance, and you feel you've discovered something as palpable, as tangible, as if you're, you know, discovering physical, geographical territory sort of centuries ago. And actually more interesting, because it's about sort of human beings rather than what the Earth has simply thrown up and left to be discovered. And I think that stays with you, and I'm sure everyone here that's in social sciences will recognise that. And as Julia has said, and Nick has said, and the applications of it are so unbounded that it is the best possible training, it seems to me, and the best possible way to engage with the world, because it's about the world. And I know my colleagues in the arts and humanities think much the same. I have this debate all the time at home with my wife. My wife read English and naturally sort of thinks of the world through the eyes of the humanities. But I think this is part of the richness of our traditions of intellectual inquiry in this country, that they coexist together. In most universities, of course, they are brought together. The fact that we have a specialist institution, more or less specialist institution, in LSE allows a greater focus. But actually, I've always found when I was studying here that the interaction in the University of London, which was a bit more prominent as an institution when I was here, but the colleges, you know, across the road and further around, had been a source of that cross-fertilisation that's always been there. And I say all this, and it's important, I think, to emphasise the role of social sciences and humanities in the academy. And again, I thought this was uncontroversial, but I found, and my distinguished former colleague and predecessor as the university's minister, John Denham, is here with us, and colleagues from the political world. I was giving evidence to the Science and Technology Select Committee last week on the Science and Innovation Strategy, which we published before Christmas, and which I'll say a few words about. And to my slight surprise, the committee were, you know, very broadly supportive of it, but they seemed to find objection to the fact that it included the humanities and the social sciences, that they felt this should be about the physical sciences only, which again sort of rather surprised me. And in the strategy, right from the beginning, we say, we take the Wissenschaft definition, that we regard the humanities and social sciences as being part of the great family that we have there. But it seems so obvious to me that these connections, and Julia and Nick have made the point, these connections, they're so clear. And my work as a science minister in government, every day I'm exposed to this. We had a discussion on Ebola for example, a few days ago, and the work that's being done to combat that terrible outbreak. Obviously, it has very important medical research and applications that are going on there. But for me, one of the most fascinating things was the contribution of social anthropologists who had were reporting on and advising on how the handling of dead bodies, human corpses, is absolutely intrinsic to the transmission of this disease, and of course is determined very much by the cultural norms that the social anthropologists are there to discover. So there could not be anything more central to a current emergency than the one of the disciplines that is at the heart of social sciences. So it's I am defiant in insisting that we should capture all of the sciences, capture in our definition of science the humanities and the social sciences as well. Not that definitions are easy to stick by. I think I was looking at the Academy of Social Sciences gave a definition of social sciences: disciplined curiosity about the arrangements by which people live together, which is, I think, a pretty succinct encapsulation of social sciences. But I'm going to shamelessly suck up to Conor here now, since well, I knew he was chairing it.
There is no time limit. There's no time limit on your presentation, Minister.
I pulled down from my bookshelf my well-thumbed edition of Conor's Hamelin Lectures of 2005, which is a fantastic read if any of you haven't read them. And and it's about human rights, of course. But I thought his what he said about human rights actually applies to the social sciences against that definition of disciplined curiosity. I rather liked what Conor said about human rights as being about the process of arguing, urging, campaigning, denouncing, encouraging, and asserting that all this advances the world's understanding of human rights. And I think that has a lot to carry across to social sciences as well. So it doesn't need to conform to very precise definitions of the discipline. Let me do what I'm supposed to do, which is to say, as a policymaker, what I think are the policy directions that I hope we can share, and if not, then we can certainly debate. We set it out just before Christmas in our 10-year strategy for science innovation, and it reflected a consultation that had taken place, in which the British Academy and other learned societies, as well as institutions and individuals, had contributed. And what it looked to do was to, I think, reflect what both Julia and Nick commented on, which is the justified position of confidence that I think UK science and social sciences and the humanities enjoy at the moment. We, by any measure, this is an area of strength and national pride, and I think it is increasingly recognised around the world, in this country, and not just within the academic world, but absolutely within the world of policymakers. I mean, the REF was a wonderful testimony to that. When Julia mentioned the ingenuity of social scientists in re-ranking or producing rankings that capture things, I was reminded of Garrison Keillor, you know, in his Lake Wobegon days. I think it's the beginning of every one of his short stories talks about Lake Wobegon, where all the men are good-looking and all the children are above average. And I think the spirit of that has gone to play in the analysis of the rankings there. But actually,
I think it's all the women are strong, all the men are beautiful, and all the children are above average.
There we are. There's a fan. Exactly. But it was a testimony to what we all know, which is that the quality, the excellence that Nick talked about of science in this country is formidable. You know, 72% of the submissions to the REF and the units of assessment as world class is a tremendous reflection of the state of UK science in this broad definition. And it seems to me, in terms of the future, it seems to be an obvious reflection that if you want to think about how you're going to earn your living as a nation in the future, it's probably appropriate to ask that question from time to time, as it is for us all, as it is for parents of children, then the answer, it seems to be, is likely to look at your strengths and then to ask yourself whether these areas of strengths are likely to be in demand in the years ahead. And when it comes to universities, when it comes to science, broadly defined, we know that as the world becomes better educated, as that it becomes more technologically sophisticated, as it becomes, on the whole, but not exclusively, wealthier, then what we are good at seems clear to be in increasing demand. So I think we are in a position of strength, and when we set up the 10-year look ahead as a plan for growth, these words are significantly chosen because we expect to be able to build on that. But if you are looking ahead, I think it is appropriate to ask some questions about how the world is changing and how the context is changing. Certainly you need stability, and certainly you need to respect the sources of those strengths. But I was I enjoyed writing the strategy with colleagues, because it seemed to me that looking at all the responses to the consultation we had, we were able to distill out some themes that are, I think, are common ground amongst everyone that takes an interest in this area, starting with excellence. You know, excellence is at the heart of our reputation, is the foundation of our reputation, and it doesn't happen by accident, and I think we need to be respectful of some of the things that contribute to that. Independence, as the other panelists mentioned. Sometimes, I dare say, university ministers of one colour or another might wish they were able to direct universities, but actually not really, because actually it is the fierce assertiveness and independence of universities that is the source of our strength, and any such thoughts tend to be fleeting and instantly replaced by a recognition that actually the robust independence of our institutions is absolutely the foundation of our excellence. The principles that have been established through debate and through public policy being advanced of an independence in funding terms as well, so that peer review is the way in which particular projects are selected for public funding. That can be, as everyone who has been part of that process knows, that can be sometimes a challenging experience, and sometimes it can lead to unwelcome results, but it's absolutely the foundation of the level of excellence that I think has been demonstrated in the REF. I think the dual funding system that we have for research, and of course it applies to all of the different disciplines, is absolutely important, that we fund through peer review. We fund excellent projects and excellent propositions, but we also, through the HEFCE process, recognise, and informed by the REF, we recognise institutional capability, and that provides a long-term or medium to long-term security of funding. So I think these are important principles that we should reflect on, and I think we... our success is built on them, and we need to continue them in future. The second theme that we talk about in the strategy is one of collaboration, and all the speakers mentioned that. The school is founded on the idea that these adjacent disciplines will inform one another, and that the boundaries between disciplines, such as they are purported to be, are not that hard. They are permeable and should inform each other. And I think that is true, as I mentioned, across between subject areas, beyond the social sciences and beyond humanities too. I think this is increasingly the case, and other speakers have made mention of it. Some of the most interesting and thrilling work is when researchers in different disciplines come together. So, for example, some of the medical research that depends on the analytical capabilities of big data, for example, and some of the technical capabilities that we have there, of bringing people together in a way that is much more collaborative than ever before. Collaboration between academics and industrialists and the commercial world, and the LSE located here, between Westminster and the city, has always had that sort of coursing through its veins. And increasingly, we see right across the country the close links between our best institutions and their local economies. Unambiguously now, the universities are the leaders of their local economies, wherever they are, and often of the national economy too. The idea of a city, much studied, and it's one of the areas that I've long had a particular interest in, I think is analogous to a university in many ways. What is a city? It's something, somewhere that brings people together so that they can specialise but collaborate, so that they can work with each other to do things that are not possible if you're in isolation. They bring different skills, different attributes, different talents together. And that is, I think, increasingly a reflection of how universities and good research in the social sciences and beyond work. So the question for us is, how can we make sure our arrangements, institutional and policy, reinforce collaboration, support it, and don't put impediments to it in place? The third theme that of five that we identify in the strategy is that of agility. And that is about pace. One of the things that people observed when we were discussing the strategy in prospect was just how the pace of innovation, the pace of discovery, the pace of transmission of ideas is quickening all the time. For all sorts of reasons, the commercial appetite to take on discoveries and apply them, the physical means of communicating electronically rather than just through printed matter, the internationalization of academia, meaning that we're not just talking to people who are geographically proximate. All of these things mean that the pace is increasing. And so again, our arrangements, both within institutions and in public policy, must make sure that we can keep pace with that, that we don't lose opportunities by being ponderous and cumbersome in our approaches, that funding streams are agile enough to be able to not commit all of our resources for all of the foreseeable future, but to allow for the sudden possibility of important research that needs to have funding available for it. So informed by that, in allocating the science capital for the next 5 and 6 years, we reserve some back to keep for the challenges that will emerge for the research councils, principally to fund the challenges in future years, to make sure that we are agile as we can be. The fourth theme was place, and I think there is, both within government and within institutions, a greater recognition than there ever has been of the importance of place, whether it is local leadership, whether it is the clustering of like-minded people in institutions and discipline. They can add so much to each other that we should consider this. And John Denham has done great work on this in Southampton, and convened an excellent seminar there to involving the universities to further advance the possibility of leadership there. And finally, in the strategy, we talk about openness. Some of these developments, technological and others, give us the ability to communicate way beyond lecture halls like this. And there is an increasing appetite and expectation, I think, on the part of the public, that they shouldn't be excluded from the kind of inquiry that takes place here, that they should be they should see what's going on, they should know what's going on, and they should participate in it. And of course, Nick's own review on climate change was something that sparked, encouraged, and facilitated a mass involvement from people a long way from being employed in the disciplines that were covered by his review, but nevertheless felt and were right to feel that they have a stake in it and have something to say around it. So it seems to me that we start from a position of great strength. I don't think, notwithstanding the exchanges I have with select committees, that anyone takes serious exception to the idea that social sciences, the humanities, should be considered with the physical sciences and engineering in quite the way that Nick describes, not as rivals, but as complementary. I think there is a recognition across party and across the country that we have something very substantial and precious in our capability, our force in research, and that we need to add to it over the years ahead. That we are in a position, if we think clearly about the future, and it's not principally the government, given the independence of the institutions that that will enact the policies that will give expression to it, but if all of us think ahead and make sure that we are continue our traditions of excellence, that we are as collaborative as anywhere in the world and lead the pace in that, that we're flexible and agile and can take opportunities, that we recognise the increasing importance of place, and that we lead the world in the openness of our inquiry. That, I think, is a recipe for the continuation of the successes that we've enjoyed in recent years. I know for John and I will take the same view. For those of us that have the privilege to be the sponsors of this community in public life, it is a tremendous privilege and a tremendous honour, as it is to be back here at the school. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much, Greg. We have till 25 past seven, and I have a question or two. But I'm wondering whether people want to catch my eye as well. I think I'll ask my question and then I might come to the audience. There's a water bargaining crisis.
There. I will, yeah. There's no crisis.
My question is to all three, but I want to come to the audience before we go to the answers. And if we can be short, we can get a bunch in. We concede, looking at us, the arts and humanities and social sciences people broadly, that we need to show some kind of impact for our research. And you kind of say we can have money for research. So this is sort of important meetings of mind. What I'm interested in, the question I've got, is how strict should we be about knowing in advance what the impact's going to be, because, or what it might be. Quite a lot of us in humanities and social sciences say we're going to research X. Now, and then we end up producing some really interesting stuff on Y, but we couldn't prove that we were going to come up with Y when we bid for the money for X. So just to reflect on that and think about how much we want to be prescriptive about impact. This is a big sensitive issue in the universities. But is there anybody who wants to kick us off before I go to the panel? We have, and even though I obviously know Alan, who you are, could you just say, as the microphone hurtles towards you, who you are, and if it's directed at a particular person to whom it's directed?
Well, it was responding to your point about how much should we have a clear goal. I was just going to talk of my own experience of having recently done a review for the government of the child protection system, which has led to radical changes, so had very big impact. But it stems from work which began without that goal in mind at all. It began as a curiosity as to how it could be in such a mess. And I ended up getting a detour into aviation for quite a while, and into accountancy, all sorts of things. And you know, then it sort of came together. But if you'd asked me years ago to specify, I would have been doing very dull research instead of having a very good time following my curiosity.
Yeah, and if we chased you for impact, you mightn't have been so hot in the application form at the time, is what you're sort of implying.
I wouldn't have had the impact I had.
Yeah. Is there anybody else who wants to ask a separate question? Yeah, right at the back, and we're proving the fitness. We're not. We have a huge number of stewards. Your name, sir, and a brief question for the panel.
My name's Matthew Holm. It's for the whole panel, and it's just taken up on some of the points just made. Is getting funding for humanities, government otherwise, is it having criteria from other subjects? So should there be more sort of distinctive humanity, unique humanities criteria for getting funding, as opposed to being judged, you know, maybe using the same criteria as other disciplines?
Right, brilliant. Thanks a lot. And I think I'm going to have Simon, who will now tell us who he is, and a quick question. And then we'll go to the panel, briefly.
Simon Hicks, the professor in the government department here at the LSE. I had a follow-on question from that, which is that we've seen, I mean, you know, we have this kind of collective love in about how wonderful the humanities and the social sciences are, but we've seen a relative decline in funding for the public funding for the humanities and social sciences over the last decade. I'm just intrigued at what is the evidence base for the continued high funding for the STEM subjects relative to the humanities and social sciences? And is it based on impact of research, or is it based on productivity gains in the economy, or the probability that these kids will get jobs in the creative industries or in the natural sciences? Yeah. Okay. What's the evidence basis for this, and what does the evidence say?
Right, thanks, Simon. I think we'll start with Nick and go to Julia and Greg, but what I'm going to start doing is interrupting you, so keep the responses brief if you can. Nick, do you want to kick off on these? Choose which one.
Yeah, let me say something about impact. I think a rather general idea on impact about is there a good chance that this program of research will influence our understanding in an important way about things that matter. Now, I know it's a rather general statement, but I think in most of the things that we set out to do, I think we should be able to say something about the answer to that question. We've all got our own stories. My very first research grant was £750 from the British Academy in 1974 to study one Indian village in Muradabad district of UP. I've been working on that village now for 40 years, and we've got one data set, 100% sample of households for every decade since independence, because there were two before we went. And so we built a data set which enables us to understand how people's incomes, family circumstances change over a long period of time. Now, that hasn't immediately had an impact on government policy, say, in India, although I've spent quite a lot of time explaining the story to the Prime Minister and other members of the Cabinet. But what we have to do is to, when we embark on something like that, to be able to suggest how it changes our understanding, in this case of income mobility and changing circumstances. I don't think there's a license to explore simply because you think you're smart, whatever it is that you're interested in, on an unlimited scale. There is, I think, it is a good idea to encourage people to have, or give people some of their time, and that's what I take it that QR is about, to do that kind of thing. But it's not unlimited. So when we pursue a research grant, we ask for a substantial amount of money to do something. I think there is an obligation to illustrate at least what it might influence. So I'm having it both ways. Some of our time through QR, good idea, pursue whatever it is that interests us, but on the basis of a track record of having done something in the past, and then on the specific, the other side of the dual funding, then it seems to me to ask people to show why there's a reasonable expectation of some impact, I think that's very reasonable.
Yeah, yeah. Thanks. Julia, do you have something to add from that point of view?
I mean, just to come in here, on the talks about the impact agenda and whether you can show in advance. And I think one of the issues that comes up for social sciences is the way that it's framed at the moment is very much based on a kind of STEM model. So you grow some cultures in the lab, and then you do a little bit more kind of research and development, and 15 years later you get a little white pill, which you can patent, and then you can sell. And so linked to the impact agenda is a commercialization agenda, linked to our innovation and excellence funding, the high funding, actually, which we use for an awful lot of our communication activities, is an expectation that you will then be able to commercialize. But it's very difficult to commercialize into pattern social science research. It doesn't work that way. And moreover, the impacts that we're talking about having are on policy or on public understanding or on our identity, some of them very difficult to measure. But also we know that they can be quite serendipitous. And certainly if you're talking about influencing policy, then you're really talking about, are you pushing against an open door or are you actually counterculture? So is the only impact you're having actually quite a conservative, conventional one because you're only telling policymakers what they already wanted to know or to hear and providing them evidence which is quite useful for their purposes? If you're resistant, if you're oppositional in the evidence that you're coming up with isn't convenient or doesn't fit with the prevailing policy wishes, then it's very unlikely you're going to have an impact, at least during a particular policy cycle. So there's a fair amount of serendipity there, and it also takes a fair amount of time. We've done our own analysis of the time, as it were, between our impact, the research being done and produced, and then the impact it's actually had. It takes about 6 or 7 years. But actually, for the same proportion of our research, it took about 6 to 7 years to impact, is actually where we had a policy impact and then we just went and wrote up the research afterwards. Because we're called into government for our expertise and our arguments and our wider experience, and not because we grew those little cells in that little culture dish, which then produced a little white pill. So the way that we engage with public debate and with public policy is not necessarily this very, very linear route, which I think is sometimes envisaged in the way that we think about impact. And also, just to take in time that time dimension. So the issue about the dual funding stream, absolutely. You know, QR is fantastic. We'd like more of it, just to put a marker down there. Conor said we weren't going to bid for resources. I'm not that shameless. so I'm not that polite, I'm afraid. But also just in terms of the dual funding stream, being able to have the opportunity to pursue research along lines which may not have already been thought of by those who are allocating those funding streams. So open funding streams, I think, are important. But also a recognition that, do you know what, if you're starting off your PhD and the Research Council is asking you to show your impact after a year, you are unlikely to get anything which is really of any significance. You might get dissemination, but you're not going to be able to show impact. So it's a recognition when it comes to that funding stream as well that actually impacts are tentative, and actually what you really want is actually making a difference, not just having a lot of hype. So I just need a little bit more sophistication around the impact debate.
Right, thanks. Sophistication, Greg, around the impact debate, and also not forgetting the audience's suggestions of certain spitting race, I think it might have been referred to earlier. And as short as you can, because we'll try and get another round in.
Sure, no, sorry. I mean, on impact, I mean, it is obviously right to retain an ability for curiosity-driven research. It's absolutely essential to it. I was talking to Lord Krebs the other day. He was telling me that his discipline is in this study of birds and how that has led to looking at financial markets, some of the kind of patterns that he discovered in the natural world applying to networks there. And he, needless to say, when he was embarking, he never thought that he would be writing papers on financial markets as a result, and I'm sure I haven't read the paper, but I dare say that it's highly impactful. So you do need to.
Andy Haldane liked it.
Did he? Well, I will certainly read the paper then. As Nick says, I think, and these things are difficult to get right, and I don't think there's a particular formula that can crack it. But you know, what Nick said is justified, that it is clearly highly desirable to be able to show that this is making an impact, that it is making a difference. Sometimes that will be ex post, and actually through the REF, it seems to me institutions have been able to include things that have been impactful that perhaps didn't have the impact that was intended when the work was first embarked on. And I think, you know, in terms of the lessons to be drawn from this REF, I'd be interested in comments from the room, but on the impact, I get the feeling that it it was less difficult to have a kind of reasonable reflection than sometimes people thought going into it, that they were a bit more concerned than the outcome. But I didn't make the evaluation, but I'd be interested in people's views on that. In terms of the evidence base and the ability for the humanities and the social sciences to be funded alongside STEM, I mean, clearly there are different bodies that make different decisions on this. All I would say that one of the key calls that I've had to make in the last 6 months is when we introduced or announced the introduction of the postgraduate loan scheme for taught postgraduate degrees, £10,000 available. There was a school of thought that argued, consistent with some sort of recent arguments, that this should be for STEM subjects. I was very clear that the evidence base, as you put it, was just as convincing for the social sciences and the humanities that this was in every respect, that it was going to be a good investment for the nation as well as for the individual, that it was in terms of access and participation, it was just as desirable that brilliant people in the humanities should be able to pursue their studies to the next level as in STEM, and that argument was accepted, and it's one that I will make. Nick is here, represents the British Academy, and I dare say, you know, the friendly rivalry between the other learned societies are about making this argument for social sciences in the area in which the decisions on who gets most of the pot that's available.
Thanks, Greg. Just very, very quickly, or we just, it's almost like, yeah, only a correction, is it?
It's a statistic in response to the question, Simon, here. It's the, if you look at reveal preference in the language of the nerdy economists amongst us, and what do people choose? More than half the overseas students who come to this country choose the humanities and social sciences. There's an international reveal preference about the importance of what we do. They come here, more than half of them, to do the humanities and social sciences.
I'm looking around. I have a question. I think we can't ignore it. It's for you, I think, Greg. The new counterterrorism and security bill. Mm-hmm. I mean, we know the British Academy's position, mm-hmm, very critical. LSE's issued a statement, very critical. There's a letter declaring an interest. I'm one of the signatories. Mm-hmm. 524 academics. Mm-hmm. We're deeply concerned that the counterterrorism and security bill, currently being debated in Parliament, will place an unlawful and unenforceable duty on educational institutions and staff. I won't go into the thing, but there's a great fear that exactly what you applauded is going to be made much more difficult by a bureaucratic imposition of constraints on speech in universities, all because, you know, there's a scared idea about extremism, but it's not violent extremism, it's just extremism. So you will know there's great concern. I know it's not your ministry. I imagine you will have one or two comments on it, because I think it's before, sure, the Lords tomorrow. But I think I am hogging it a bit as chair. I mean, do you want to take that one very,
sure,
quickly?
Absolutely.
Yeah, if you don't mind. It's
absolutely
really aimed at you.
Sure. I think we need to make the distinction. So there is the legislation which imposes a duty to have regard specifically to people being drawn into terrorism. And then there is the guidance that is reflected there. And I think it is a reasonable reflection for not just universities, but for the other groups to, as it were, to have this in mind, you know, to understand, you know, that there may be occasionally people who have terrorist intent, and we see this around the world. And that is no more than a recognition, and there are already University UK guidance on these matters. That is, I think, accepted. In terms of the guidance, and I think there have been some sort of concerns expressed about them. I think two things to say. One is that they're in draft for consultation, and part of the point of parliamentary debate and indeed consultation is to be able to have them shaped to avoid what would clearly be the total opposite of the intention of that, and the and more than that, the importance of free speech as a kind of shining contradiction to what terrorism aims at has to be, the universities have to be the place when not only is that possible, but it is where it is positively encouraged. So I think, talking to my colleagues, and I do talk to my colleagues across government on this, that is absolutely understood, and I hope and expect we'll be able to get to a position that reflects in the guidance what is the intention of the legislation. It'll be debated in the Lords tomorrow, and there'll be a response in due course to the consultation.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, that's very helpful. We are beginning to wind down, but I think it's good. We have a gentleman with his hand up with the degree of enthusiasm that warrants notice. Do we have anybody? I think this may be it. We have another gentleman, slightly less enthusiastic, therefore has to be shorter. And then we will finish within the next 3 minutes. Sir, it'll need to be pretty succinct and possibly aimed at a single member of the panel.
To the panel in general, my name is John Koval. I'm from one of your colonies called the United States. And one of the things that concerns me that I think the humanities and social sciences are missing enormously is what is happening in the cities in the world. And I look at my own country and my own city of Chicago, that we're becoming two worlds, a white world and a brown and a black world.
Yeah.
And the discrimination, the segregation that is going on in the urban world is something I think that needs to be profoundly addressed by the humanities and the social sciences.
Right, we'll take it as a kind of observation, I think, John, but it's a very important point. I'm glad we've had it registered. Sir, you've got a microphone. Name and quick question.
Okay, my name is Christian Enskrober. I'm from Austria, so I don't know anything special about your university, but my question goes to Professor Black, because you talked a lot about application and impact of your research, but there may be some research which has no direct application or which is foreseeable has no application, and you didn't talk about that so much. So I would ask you how would you defend projects, for example, in philosophy of science, where you can see, oh, this has clearly no impact, or no impact on policy making, or no practical impact.
Yeah, good, please. Thanks, Christian.
Thank you. No, it's a very good question. I mean, I talked about impact because I was set a question and a thing to talk about when I talked about impact. But in terms of pure research and pure curiosity, that is the lifeblood of academia. That is why people go into academia, because they're curious. As Arlene said, you never know where it's going to take you. And we should preserve a space for that. We should preserve a space for what in science is called pure research. So you're just inquiring because you don't know where it will go. And that is hugely valuable. But then even within the philosophy of science, for example, you take here, so we have philosophers, and our philosophers are nicely abashed and slightly embarrassed about their impacts, actually, because they were rated very highly. They didn't think they would be. But
sort of shames.
My God, we had impact, and it was actually on the theory of probability, and looking deep into the philosophy of probability theory, and from that, actually working with our statisticians in the area of climate change, in fact, to argue that probabilistic models are probably that's nicely ironic, not the best way to be thinking about future risks. And then, in fact, we need to be using scenario analysis to reveal uncertainty and not pretending a certainty that we can get through fiddling around with probability. So that actually came not through any direct desire to think, I'm going to influence the Dutch government, as it was, on how they think about climate change. Oh, what do I need to do that? I need to roll back and go into theory of probability. It started off with curiosity, thinking about probability. It started off with conversations, talking to people in our the centre for the analysis of time series, which I'm reliably informed is not the same as time series analysis, and I just say yes, absolutely, to just about different ideas and what do you think. And then there was the Grantham Institute, and they do climate change, and there's quite a lot of modelling that goes on there. So, hey, this thing came together. So you have to preserve that space for pure research, because you don't know. It goes to the future. It goes to the pace of change. We don't know what the future questions are going to be. We're going to need to answer. So we need to just enable ourselves to be able to answer them as and when they arise.
Very good. Nick, very, very briefly, and Greg, it'll be minute, but a tiny wrap-up.
I think we ought to respond to our friend from Chicago. Let me just draw attention to Amartya Sen's book on, fellow of the British Academy, on identity and violence. And what the major theme of that book was to draw attention to how dangerous it is to define people by one thing, by their religion, their language, their colour, and that we are that a human being has many dimensions. And he developed that to show how such definitions could lead to violence, and he used that argument to argue very strongly against segregated schools, including segregated schools by faith. So that seems to me to be the kind of philosophical and practical inquiry that starts by saying, what are we like as human beings, and starts to take you fairly quickly to some of the deep policy questions. There are obviously many more kinds of answers, but I just wanted, yeah. I didn't want to leave it lying on the table.
Thanks, Nick. Good. And Greg, are we happy to wrap up?
Sure. And Julia answered it expertly. Of course we need to be able to recognise the contributions of people that for whom impact is a difficult thing to define, let alone to demonstrate.
We're pretty well there. I just want to notice from the British Academy, Tim Brazel, who is absolutely instrumental in organising this, and Jane from the Institute of Public Affairs. Can I call you from the Institute of Public Affairs? So people have really worked hard to make this event happen. And we thought we'd have the normal thing, Greg, which is obviously a fantastic room. We choose and also a brilliant banquet. We normally follow these things with banquet. We thought it would send the wrong message. We thought it would send the wrong message to have our usual banquet, folks. So there's nothing afterwards. But what we would like you to do, as our guests leave, because we're going to give them a glass of diluted orange juice, is to thank, in the normal way, not only the home team, Julia, and the home and away slightly team, Nick, but especially Greg, who has a busy time and lots of excuses not to be here, to come here and to speak, if I may say so, so honestly and clearly about the subject that is fantastically of interest to him. I thought at the start he was a kind of doing a job interview. I thought he was about to announce his retirement from politics. So interested was he in the social sciences. But we're very glad you came along. Yeah, and can you all, other than those who are leaving with our panel, just as you applaud, allow others to leave before you yourselves leave. So thank you very much for an excellent evening. Thank you.